Good morning. It's such a privilege to be here and just to be able to share what's on my heart and what's on God's heart about worship. So thank you. Thank you, CBC. As you know, this is my husband, Adam, and we actually met in this college in 2010.
Woo!
God sent me all the way from Poland to come here to CBC to do Karen's Bible College, and God sent Adam from England, from Lancashire, to do the same, and that's when we met, and we did 3 years, and then 2012 we graduated, and then we actually got married in this building, and it was awesome. So Lucy already introduced me, and which is really good. And I am going to speak about worship as a lifestyle, and this is such powerful thing, because about a year ago I was asking God, Lord, please teach me about worship. What is worship? I want to share with your people what worship is. And I was just really meditating on the word, and he led me to listen to these teachings by Daniel Amstutz, and it was really powerful, really inspiring. And I hope that you will be blessed and encouraged, and because I really am encouraged and inspired by that. So we're talking about the lifestyle of worship. What is worship? And worship, as Lucy already was saying today, is the relationship. Is the relationship that we have between the relationship that there is between God, the Father, and us, His children. And this is the relationship of love. And why is it that? Because the Trinity, the God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, the relationship between them is the relationship of perfect love. They love each other with unconditional love. God is love, right? God is awesome. He's not just the creator or the author of love. He is love. And that's why, like, we are meditating on the scripture today from Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. God created us for His pleasure. So before the foundations of the world, before He wanted to create the whole universe, He had in mind the relationship of love. He wanted to create a man to share the love with. He wanted to love on him. He wanted to just, you know, just to walk with him and talk with him and just bless him and just be daddy to him. That's what happened in the Garden of Eden. And, you know, I love when we come corporately, like together as a body of Christ, and we sing and we praise our Father in heaven. This is a very, very awesome and special time, and you can really be blessed, and we are blessed. But you know what? There is so much more to worship than just that, than just coming to a building like here or to a church building and worship the Father. It's so much more than that. God wants so much more in terms of worshiping Him. Do you know where this idea of coming to a place, which usually is a church building, you know, once a week or twice a week, do you know where this idea comes from? From the Old Covenant, from the Old Testament, right? When God told Moses to build a tabernacle, it was a place where the sacrifices were being given all the time to cover the blood of the animals, of bulls and lambs, was being shed on a daily basis to cover the sins of the people. And the tabernacle had obviously the holy place and the most holy place, the Holy of Holies. And this was a very special place where God was dwelling, but the most holy place was only a place that only one person once a year was allowed to enter in. It was the high priest. It started from Aaron. So people at that time, they didn't have what we have today as new believers, as newborn believers of the Almighty God. They couldn't just, you know, we have God Almighty living on the inside of us today, which is awesome. They didn't have that. They weren't born again. Only Aaron, the high priest, was allowed once a year to enter into the Holy of Holies. And there was special, obviously, he was giving sacrifices and he had special clothes to be wearing. Mm. Yeah. So I would like to speak about. So I mentioned this kind of old covenant model of worship, right? Giving sacrifices and everything. It was very a lot of rituals, a lot of details. God required a lot of things to be done in a specific way. And now we are obviously in the new covenant. And what's happening in the new covenant? Let's open the Bible in John chapter 4. And this is the story when Jesus meets the Samaritan woman at the well. And I presume all of you, or most of you, know this story very well. And it's a beautiful story. It's got many things, many things in there. It's just so many things. We could talk for many hours about. Jesus wanted to go to Galilee with his disciples, and for some reason he wanted to go through Samaria. Disciples didn't understand that. Why through Samaria? Because Samaritans weren't considered, they weren't Jews, they were half-breed, they were half Jews and half Gentiles. So they weren't respected in the eyes of Jews, I can put it this way. So disciples really didn't understand why Jesus wanted to go through Samaria. Why would he? But that's what he wanted. And he did. And he met the woman at the well. And we can read in chapter 4, from verse 7. There comes a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus says to her, "Give me to drink." For his disciples were gone away to the city to buy food. Then says the woman of Samaria to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God, and who it is that says to you, 'Give me to drink,' you would have asked of him, and he would have given you living water." So obviously Jesus is not speaking about the physical water as she thought he did. He's speaking about the living water, the spiritual water. Verse 11, the woman says to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From where then have you that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof, himself and his children and his cattle?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." The woman says to him, "Sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come here to draw." Jesus says to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You have well said, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and he whom you now have is not your husband. In that you said truly." The woman says to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worship in this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." Okay, so here we're entering the conversation between Samaritan woman and Jesus. Comes to the idea, the subject of worship. It's just the beginning of that. Verse 21, Jesus says to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour comes when you shall neither in this mountain, nor yet at Jerusalem, worship the Father." And let's just stop here for a few minutes. So Jesus, speaking to Samaritan woman, he already said that, "Woman, look and believe me, the hour comes when you shall neither in this mountain." You say that in this mountain is the place when you should worship, right? You say that Jews say that in Jerusalem there is a place to worship. But I say that neither here in this mountain or in Jerusalem you will be worshiped the Father. He'll be worshiping the Father. So he's saying, okay, you, there was a place. You know about this mountain as being a place that you come corporately and you worship God. And Jerusalem is the place where Jews go and worship, right? So there was a place, like a building, something special. But now he's saying from now on, there's not going to be a place that you will be going and worshiping. So this is one thing. And another thing is, and he's saying, not God, he's saying the Father. But from now on, you'll be worshiping the Father. Which is a huge revelation. This is the first time ever Jesus is actually mentioned in the Bible that anyone will be worshiping the Father. God, the Father. Before, Jews are worshiping, they were worshiping God, Almighty, Holy, Righteous. They were trembling. They were sending Moses to go and speak to God because they were so trembling. They would say, no, you are our leader. And you go and talk to God. And then you come and tell us what he wants. You know, what shall we do? But now Jesus is introducing to Samaritan woman the idea of a new covenant worship, of worshiping the Father. And it's amazing that this woman, she's not a man. This is number one. She's not a man. In these days, women weren't very highly respected, I could say. So she was a woman, and she was a Samaritan woman, you know, half breed, not even a Jew. And Jesus having this dialogue with her, we read about that she actually was living in a sin at that point, right? She had five husbands, but now she was with a man who wasn't her husband. So it's amazing how Jesus just looked beyond, you know, these cultural norms, that she's a woman, that she's from Samaria, and she doesn't even have a husband. And he decided to reveal one of the greatest revelations of worship, of a new covenant worship to this lady. That's what he does. As we know, he was going to places that everyone else wouldn't go. He was with the sinners, those who were, you know, despised by all the society. That's where he was going, to say that the kingdom of God is at hand. Praise Jesus. So verse 22. You worship, you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour comes, and now is, when the true worshippers, I love that, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeks such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. This verse is just so great. So much in it. He's talking about true worshippers. He's talking about true worshippers worshiping the Father again. God the Father as the Father. And he's talking about worshiping the Father in spirit and in truth. And how is it possible? How can we worship the Father in the spirit? How is it possible? Look, when we go back to Garden of Eden, when God created Adam and Eve after his image and likeness, they were spiritually alive. They were talking to God on a daily basis. They were just communing with God. He had fellowship with them all the time. They were spiritually alive, and he said to them, you know, you can eat of all the trees in this garden, but just don't eat from this tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because if you do, you will surely die, right? So what happened when they did eat of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil? They didn't die physically, right? They were still alive. However, they knew that something changed. Something changed. They discovered all of a sudden that they were naked. So what happened was, the relationship, the peace they had, this pleasure in God's, you know, presence and just enjoying Garden of Eden, all of a sudden this changed. They were scared, they were ashamed, they were afraid, they felt condemned, they were hiding before God. Earlier they were just talking to him freely, but now they were hiding. What happened? Something must have happened. Like God said, you will surely die. And yes, they did die, but not in physical, but in the spirit. This communion, this relationship, this perfect relationship, this perfect relationship of perfect love that was between God the Father and them, disappeared. They were separated at this point forever. Just saying at this point. And that's why God had to put them out of the garden, because he knew if in this sinful state they would eat from the tree of life, they would have to remain in the sinful state forever. And he didn't want that. He loved them so much, obviously. Right? That's why he had to remove them from the garden. So what happened? So coming back to the scripture, what Jesus said, that the true worshippers will worship the Father in the Spirit. How can we then worship the Father in the Spirit? How is it possible? In order to do it, we have to be spiritually alive. Because God is a living spirit. He is alive. And it's just powerful. Because we have a scripture in John chapter 1, verse 12 and 13. I love the scripture. But as many as received him, which is talking here about Jesus, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So this scripture is very clear that because of Jesus, those who received him, those who believed on his name, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. So what's lost in the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve sinned and they disobeyed God, Jesus restored through his perfect sacrifice on the cross. Right? What a powerful good news. And now we were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but by the Spirit of God. We are born of God. That's why we, receiving Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, receiving the forgiveness of sins, we were made alive again in our spirit, man. Our spirit man became alive again. We became alive, born again and alive. That's why we can now approach the Father and say, Abba, Daddy, and we can worship him in the spirit, because we are alive. The Spirit of God dwells in us. Right? Amen. How powerful is that? That we actually became the temple of the Holy Spirit. We have so many scriptures saying that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So if we are the temple, we don't need to go anymore to the temple as such to worship God. Because we are the temple, right? That's why I heard Andrew Womack saying often, that's why when we were praying, we were bowing our head, because we are talking to the Father who is inside of us. That's funny. But that's the truth. The Holy Spirit, God Almighty. How amazing is that? God Almighty who created the whole earth and universe that we can't even comprehend, we can't measure. We just can't measure. He lives on the inside of us. How is that possible? And we don't explode and we're actually alive? Because God had to cleanse us. He had to make us pure and clean. And this he did by his Holy Spirit. He did by himself, right? He cleansed us, he sanctified us, he made us as holy and pure and clean as he himself. What an awesome privilege. What an awesome privilege. And we, you know, as much as it's amazing to come, and I love the signs that I said, when we come together as worshippers and the sons and daughters of our Father, and we come and just worship him cooperatively, and we can sing and we can play and we can dance. And you know, those who think, I underline, those who think that they can't sing, which may not necessarily be true, know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You know, we are all the sons and daughters. We are created after His image and likeness because we are in His spirit, because we are alive. We are alive in Him. So, you know, we can just say, Father, I love you and just thank you for who you are and what you've done for me. And I just adore you and I just admire you and I just want to live for you. Whatever you want, I will do. Wherever you want me to go, I will. Because I just want to say thank you for your love. I just want to say thank you for how awesome you are. This is what it is. It's not about, you know, some people might think, oh, you know, I have to somehow please God. This was the, you know, like the law mentality of the Jews in the old covenant. They had to, you know, the blood of animals was shed so much. Every single sin was had to be covered by the blood of the animal all the time, all the time, all the time. It was like an ending story. So they had to please God, had to please God. It is a mentality of pleasing God, pleasing God, pleasing God. But today is changed. We don't start from perspective like, you know, I want to please God because otherwise I'm not worthy. No, God already said, you know, I qualified you, you know, to be the partaker of the inheritance of the saints in light. You are already qualified. You are already a son and daughter. So now you don't have to come, you know, and come to God and start praying, say, oh, Lord, make me worthy, oh, Lord, I want to please you in this respect. We just come and say, oh, Father, I love you so much. I thank you for what you've done. So I want to praise you, and I want to love you back, basically. Obviously, we know we can't outlove God, like we can't outgive Him. We know that. He is so much huge, so much bigger and greater than whatever we can imagine. But we can just say, thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Daddy, that you cleansed me. Thank you that I am a new creation. I am a new creation and I don't have to live in condemnation anymore. I have put a new man on me, which is Jesus Christ. That's why when you look at me right now, you see your son. We are seated in heavenly places in Jesus Christ and at the right hand of the Father. How awesome is that? What a privilege. Almighty God who created the whole universe, which will be destroyed like that one day. And He lives in us. And He loves us. And he loves to be with us. And He is with us. And He just loves when we speak to Him. He loves to have communion with us. You know, this, He's got so much pleasure watching us and coming to Him and calling Him Daddy. You know, we don't have to be in this respect like fearful, you know, if He's going to strike us dead. You know what I mean? You know, like in the Old Testament. They kind of like, you know, they never knew. They might have done something wrong and they would be struck dead. It's not like that today. Because of Jesus Christ, He was the perfect Lamb of God. He was the perfect sacrifice. And that's why we can just be with our Daddy. So, yes, we became the temple of God. And we have a few verses saying that. It is the 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, for instance. Know you not that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? Great. Also, we have the 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. So we know that we are the temple of God and we are also like individually, but also cooperatively as the body of Christ. It's a great scripture about that in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 21 and 22. I read this one. In whom, which is in Jesus, all the building fitly framed together grows to a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. So we are together as the building. Yes. So the relationship with God has never been about, we can say, visitation. You know, like under Old Covenant, that people are going to a place, visiting the place now and again, and bringing the sacrifices to to worship God in this way, but it's always been about the habitation, you know, like the communion with God just all the time, that He would inhabit, you know, His people, that He would inhabit us. That's what He always had in mind. And that's what He always had in mind when He was created man. So we know that when Jesus came and He died on the cross and He resurrected, He restored what was lost. What was lost? Our true identity that we had in the Father, our value, the purpose of our lives here on earth. This was lost. And Jesus came to bring it back, to restore that, what was lost, to restore our relationship with the Father. And this relationship became again very personal. That's why when He was speaking to Samaritan woman, He revealed this revelation that you will be calling God your Father. Right? That's why it's very personal. And Jesus is saying many scriptures about that. But for instance, in John 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Again, the Father. He's always talking about the Father. In John 20, verse 17, Jesus, talking to Mary Magdalene, says, it was after He resurrected, do not cling to me, do not hold me, for I have not ascended yet to the Father, but go to my brethren and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, my God and your God. That's beautiful. He was saying in His own, you know, He Himself was saying, I am going to go to my Father and your Father. Now you are my brothers. You are my brothers, you are my sisters, and I'm going to go to my Father and your Father. How amazing is that? How powerful is that? The Creator of the whole universe, Jesus, is the Word that God created the world by, the whole universe by, right? With the Word, Jesus is the Word. And the Lord Almighty, Jesus Christ, was so humble. He was so humble to come and become a creation, become a man. And so humble that then He can call people that He created His brothers and sisters. How awesome is that? How much we can learn from that? How humble He is, was and is. And He was calling us His brothers and sisters and saying, I'm going to your Father and my Father, going to your God and my God. How awesome is that? I've got 5 minutes. So we know that under the old covenant, there were priests, Levites, who were serving God. They were set apart to serve God in the temple, and they were teachers, judges, musicians. So they were like specific, it was a tribe of Levi that they were chosen from. But today we are all the worshippers of the Almighty God. And we are not, you know, like just Levites and priests. We are, it's just so much more to that. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. You are all chosen generation and a royal priesthood. Not just a few of you, you know, not just only a few of you. You all who are my sons and daughters. A holy nation, peculiar people, that you should show for the praise of Him who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. So we've been made all the worshippers, we've been made all the Levites, right? We've been all made the the priests to worship our Father, just to give him praises and to bring sacrifices to him. We are, so what we do now, we don't bring to our God anymore the physical sacrifices of lambs and bulls, and the blood is not being shed anymore, praise the Lord. But what we do now, as we read in 1 Peter 2:5, you also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices. We're bringing spiritual sacrifices. Spiritual because it's from the Spirit, right? From our newborn spirit again, because we're worshiping the Father in spirit and in truth. And what is it? Hebrew is telling us about sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. So this is what we do now. We don't bring animals, but we bring the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips. So we can sing, right? We can dance, we can play instruments if we can do it. But the fruit of our lips, you know, what we speak, the thanksgiving, what we declare, what we say to our God, thanksgiving, that's what he wants. Thanksgiving, that's what he, it's just a sweet aroma for him. That's what he's pleased with, you know? And we can just do it everywhere and all the time, you know, singing the melodies in our hearts to the Lord, as other scriptures are saying, just constantly, just this awareness, yes, my daddy loves me, I am his, he is mine forever. And I'm going to worship him and I'm going to thank him. It's how many times Paul is saying in the Bible, rejoice always, so many scriptures saying, and always with thanksgiving, thanksgiving, always. This is there for a reason, and I'm preaching not only to you, but I'm preaching to myself too. It's always, no matter what we're going through, like I started today, I'm going to keep my eyes on you, Lord, and I'm going to rejoice, because you are worthy, as we're singing today, you are worthy to be praised all the time. No matter what, no matter how I feel, I may not feel like rejoicing, I may be in pain or whatever, you know, circumstances are not necessarily sometimes encouraging, but you know what, our God doesn't change.
Amen.
The world doesn't change, and we are grounded and rooted in love of God. Jesus Christ, our rock of our salvation. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Yeah.